Jed got a haircut. All right. We are on the air, folks. I'm going to call the meeting to order. It's the Cadillac City Council's meeting, June 18th, 2012, 7 p.m. Would everyone please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. Chris, could you give us a roll call tonight?
Councilmember Malama?
Here.
Shippers?
Here.
Solomon?
Here.
Stevens?
Here.
Mayor Barnett?
Here. Thank you. All here and accounted for. Approval of the agenda. Could we have a motion to approve our agenda as presented? Unless there's any additives, Marcus, any additions, deletions, or corrections?
Not at this time.
Okay, you've got coffee over there.
Yes.
All right, you're going to be up all night.
I hope we're not going to be up all night.
Okay.
I move to approve the agenda as presented.
Okay, we have a motion. Is there support for that?
Support.
There's motion and support. Chris, could you please give us a roll call for our agenda?
Councilmember Shippers?
Yes.
Solomon?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Malama?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried. We do have an agenda. First up is public comment, or public comments, depending on who would like to speak. Public comments are limited to those items on the agenda with the exception of public hearings. It is requested that the comment time be limited to 3 minutes. Actually, this is our first public comment period in the meeting. We'll have another one at the end. We have a little bit of a lengthy meeting in some ways tonight. We'll see how it goes, but public appearances at the end under what looks to be 13 is another time for public comment. And if you would like to talk and you don't think you can stay till the end, would like to speak now, just let us know. We're fairly flexible about that, but we do want to make sure everybody can talk about items that are on the list. I see that Tony Badovinic is here tonight. Marcus, did you want to start with him or go to the general public? We have him listed under A, under public comments.
Pleasure of the council, Mr. Mayor.
Okay. Council wish to initiate our meeting with Mr. Badovinic or?
Sure.
Okay. Anthony Badovinic is in the house. Please come forward and let us know what you have.
I want to thank you all for allowing me to come here tonight and especially for putting me on the written agenda. I don't feel comfortable about showing up to meetings if I'm not on the agenda. I don't think it's too professional. I want to make about 3 minutes worth of comments. The first thing is, some of you may know I'm running for the position of Wexford County Prosecutor. I can stand here all night and tell you that I know most of you. I always like coming to these meetings because I always discover that I know about half the people. And I can bore you with the fact that I'm a trial attorney with 23 years experience, and I've handled more misdemeanors and felonies, I think I know, than any other candidate running for this position. That I have more education than any other candidate running for this position, that I've taught law classes for 11 years, that I've been the Wexford County Public Guardian Conservator for 20 years, and the Wexford County Administrator for about 15 years. But that's really enough about me, because I think there are more important things to talk about. And I don't do this lightly. The mayor and I have discussed, and a lot of other politicians have discussed, a current scourge among us, and that's known as synthetic marijuana. I have a sheet that I'd like to give all of the council members, just so you can kind of follow along. And again, I promise this won't take very long. Bill says, right, he's an attorney, right?
Mm-hmm. He gets paid by the word.
Mr. Bradovinic, is this one packet?
Or
is
yes.
This? Oh, okay.
Yes, the cook. Yeah, it looks like you might have two.
Yeah, I got two. You guys need one?
But what you need to know
got
about
just
this,
one down here,
I say this to the people in the audience as well, is there is a drug out there called synthetic marijuana, and you're saying, what the heck's that? Well, it's also known as tea. It has a number of names. It's also called spice. It's also called K2. It is plant material that is impregnated with up to 36 different chemicals. As a result of that, people get super high off it. The problem with it is you never know when people are on it and the behavior that happens once they take it. I don't say this lightly. I've been affected by this personally. I currently have an individual in Missaukee County that's charged with stabbing his brother 8 times. His brother was lucky to live. He doesn't remember any of it, and he was smoking tea before that. Some of the facts that you should know, 21% of high school seniors, according to the Center for Disease Control, now smoke marijuana or some form of it. The synthetic tea, the chemicals in it mimic THC, which is the main chemical in marijuana, but it's 100 to 800% more potent than is the THC found in marijuana. The problem with it is you never know who's smoking it or not, largely because they don't have a test for it yet. And I shouldn't say that because there was a blog on one of the newspaper sites today that they're coming out with something. I don't have to remind you that there's just all kinds of bizarre cases, and I mimicked a few on the internet. In Texas, there were two men that beat one of their fathers to death. They were high on this stuff, and he wouldn't give them money for it. You've probably all heard about, and I want to say it was Florida or a Texas case, where there was a homeless man that ate off the face of another person, and they had to shoot him. And they figured he was high on tea. And I say figure because we really don't know yet. We can't test for it. Two or three weeks ago, they arrested a person in my office in the middle of the day. He came in with a 3 or 4 foot long bladed sword. Took four police, didn't weigh 90 pounds, I exaggerate, 120 pounds, to subdue him, screaming at the top of his lungs. And the problem with this, folks, is you don't know the people that are on this and the people that aren't. And there's no way to test for it. Having said that, there are several communities, several municipalities, several townships that have passed ordinances to deal with it. And I have attached to your packet, and I draw your attention to the second page of your packet, a proposed ordinance regarding these synthetic drugs that now face us. And it's called an emergency order. I don't know whether you know it or not, but public law in Michigan allows the health officer and ordinances to adopt, or townships to adopt, cities to adopt ordinances that deal with this. You have the authority now to make tea illegal in Cadillac, Michigan. I understand there's at least one store that sells it here, and there's one in Misaukee that sells it. The other thing, and I know you're not going to do this tonight, but the other thing you need to look at is page number 3, be the second page of the ordinance, the third page. You should know all the names it goes by. It's known as Spice, Tea, Weed, Blue, Bombay, Bliss, Black Mamba. In addition to that, this ordinance also talks about bath salts. That's a little bit of a different chemical concoction than is synthetic marijuana. This ordinance, I think, is written broadly enough to encompass both of them. I would urge you, if you get the chance or the opportunity, to embrace any type of legislation like this, that you pass it immediately. I can tell you that the person who was in my office the other day and was arrested for this the next day was unable to go to court because, yes, and I'm quoting the jailer, he was bathing in the public urinal in the jail. That's how nuts it makes people. Medical technology doesn't know what it does to your brain yet. They think if it's to really young people, it changes your brain chemistry and you're never the right again. Rumor is that there is a judicial task force working on this and that we'll have legislation shortly from the state of Michigan to deal with this. If it ever comes up, if there's any conversation with any of your friends about this, I would urge you to please do something about it. Again, you have the capacity as a city to pass an ordinance. I'd ask you to consider same. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Padovinic. Anyone else wishing to come forward for a public comment? And good luck in your race, sir.
Thank you.
Anyone else wishing at this time to speak? Seeing and hearing no activity, we will proceed to the consent agenda. Could we have a motion? Looks like our city council minutes from our regular meeting on June 4th and our special meeting are both on the consent agenda for the public at home. And entertain a motion at this time or ask for one.
I move to approve the consent agenda.
Support.
Motion and support. Could we have a roll call, please, Chris?
Councilmember Spolman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Malama?
Yes.
Shippers?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried. Next, proclamations, none for tonight. Public hearings are next up. And our first public hearing is to approve a resolution to adopt ordinance number 2012-07, a lease agreement with the Northern Baptist Association. I'm going to open the public hearing at this point. Slide over first to staff, just to hear what staff has to say, and I assume someone's here tonight, Marcus?
Or I'm not. Actually going to ask Owen if you could introduce the folks that might be here this evening.
Sure.
That'd be very helpful.
Sure. I'll give you a brief info first. It was approached as part of the availability of space at the Neighbor Reserve by a gentleman wanting to start a new church organization. Showed them space, and they were very interested in that space, so we moved through the process. I'd like to introduce Mr. Malcolm Brown, who will be leading that organization. He and I have met out at the facility a couple of times. They've chosen a room to kind of use as a office and small meeting space, and then they'll be conducting their services on Sunday nights and using the big open space there only during those times. So a little bit of a unique situation on that. We've talked with the senior center, and they're very anxious to work together on that, and have no problem with it. And that's really all.
Just to add also that the lease form that we're using is a standard lease form. There's an automatic renewal term provision in it, unless either party provides a 30-day notice of termination.
So it's monthly?
Well, it's an annual lease.
It renews for a year.
Yeah, renews for a year. But you can provide a 30-day notice if you need to.
So yeah, okay. Mr. Brown?
Good evening.
Hi, Mr. Brown.
My name is Reverend Malcolm Brown. I've been a member of the living in the Cadillac area for almost 19 years. I pastored Boone Baptist Church for 3 years and then left the area, came back on semi-retirement and pastored a church in Flint in the 3rd Avenue area for 16 years and traveled back from Cadillac to Flint back and forth, going down on Wednesdays and coming back on Sundays. During that time period, our church became affiliated with the Southern Baptist Convention. We were an American Baptist church, and we became dually aligned. And when the minister of the Northern West Baptist Association heard that I was coming back to Cadillac, he approached me because Southern Baptists are considering opening new church plants, and asked me if I would be interested. And I said yes. My background is I've been in ministry for over 57 years. I worked in Youth for Christ International as a Bible club director with youth, and have worked extensively with youth. We started the February 19th meeting in a home, and we have outgrown the home. And right now we have a membership of around 19. The average age of that membership is, I'm the oldest member, and the average age of the membership is 32, or around there, with a lot of young people. I want to assure you we're not here to compete with other churches. Our goal is to minister to those who work on Sunday and have no church to go because there's no evening services around here. And so that's why we called ourselves the Rediscover Fellowship. The second aim of our fellowship is there's many, many young people within the area of Cadillac that have no contact with church, desire to have no contact with the church, desire to have no influence of the gospel of Christ on their lives, to change their lives, and we want to do something about it. And we've got young people that are interested in doing that. And so we would ask that you consider leasing to us. We promise we will not bang the property up. We will not burn it down. And we will not cause any terrorist attacks to come. But we're just here to minister to the people in Flint. The people in Cadillac who really need to be reached, who are turned off by church and need a way to come back. I've had 16 years experience of doing that because we worked in the ghetto of Flint for 16 years, and we were able to do a very successful ministry. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Malcolm. Thank you for coming. Public hearing is open still. Anyone from the public wishing to discuss any comments on the proposed lease agreement with Northern Baptist Association. Please feel free to come forward at this time if you would like to say anything. Again, anyone wishing to comment on the item in front of us at this point, which is a proposal to adopt a lease agreement with Northern Baptist Association. Seeing and hearing no one else come forward, I'm going to close the public hearing and turn this over to staff again. Mr. Petcha, any comments or thoughts with regard to the proposed lease?
No, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council. As Owen had mentioned, we met with them on site. We're comfortable in making the recommendation to council for approval this evening.
Thank you. Okay. Anybody, any questions or any discussion?
I'm assuming that he has the correct structure to be an appropriate tenant there?
Yeah, good question. They weren't officially established yet, and so they have did a little reading on the Southern Baptist Church's structure, and they have a regional agency that is officially listed under the SBC site as an approved agency, and so they kind of, as a legal entity under there, they derive their tax-exempt status. Once the church has adopted their own constitution or governing document, the church plans to put it actually in the name of the church. It'll probably take about a year for that to happen. But their regional association, which is officially listed under the SBC site, that is who we're negotiating or approving the current lease with while the church gets officially established then.
And that association has 13 churches.
Yeah, yep.
Okay, did that answer your question or questions? Councilmember Spolman.
That's the Northern Baptist Association.
Yeah, and it's actually the Northwest Baptist Association.
It's an affiliation of the Michigan Baptist Association, which is the Southern Baptist Convention of Michigan. There's 13 churches in the Northwest Baptist Association, 250 churches in the Southern Baptist Convention of Michigan.
Thank you.
Okay.
I guess I would just ask Mike if somehow we need to, just as part of the motion, say, you know, the paperwork said Northern and it's Northwest, so we just need to...
Northwest Baptist Association?
Northwest instead of Northern, so...
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Any further discussion or questions? Hearing none, could we please have a motion?
I'll make a motion that we approve the resolution to adopt ordinance number 2012-07 to do a lease agreement with Northwest Baptist Association as presented, with the any changes that replacing Northwest with the word Northern in the Northwest Baptist Association name.
Okay.
Support.
There's a motion and support. Any further or any discussion? Hearing none, Chris, could we please have a roll call on this item?
Councilmember Stevens?
Yes.
Alamo?
Yes.
Shippers?
Yes.
Bowman?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried.
Thank you.
Good luck to you, Malcolm.
Thank you.
Reverend. Next up is a public hearing to approve a resolution to adopt ordinance number 2012-08, a code of ethics for the city of Cadillac. I'm going to open the public hearing at this point. And just get a little lead in, if we could, from staff.
Be happy to. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council. This ordinance draft before you this evening is the same version that you've seen previously at the time that you did set the public hearing. At such time, there was some discussion by council about putting this in place, as there has been for quite some time. There was a survey that was shared showing a variety of municipalities across the state. We try to keep it geared more towards our neck of the woods, if you will, showing what they, if they had anything, and if they did, we had included it in your packet the last go-around. Again, there hasn't been any changes made to the document since it was last presented to you. There was no additional feedback that I had received I know, Mr. Mayor, you did inquire about the penalty provision, whether or not we should look at something other than a misdemeanor, but again, this version still has that same language in the document itself.
Yeah, my thoughts was to maybe start it for a year and add the teeth after a year to make sure everyone's caught off guard by something, and in the spirit of trying to break it out slowly, because this is a first for our city that I'm aware of. And remarkably, most cities don't have these, which is a big surprise.
And that, that section, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council, is Chapter 4 under Sanctions, Section 4-1, Violations. Just a simple sentence which currently states, "A violation of this ordinance may be punished as a misdemeanor by a fine of up to $500 and/or 90 days in jail." It does use the word "may," so that might perhaps give the flexibility that's needed, since it doesn't say "shall." Don't know if it does or not. I guess I defer to the city attorney on that. And then it says, you know, in addition, Section 4-2. You know, in addition to any other penalty, whether criminal or civil, an employee or officer who intentionally, again, key word is intentionally, violates this ordinance, again, may be subject to disciplinary action, including censure, reprimand, removal, dismissal, or discharge. So, you know, we borrowed language from a couple of other ordinances that were in place, but I think it might be somewhat standard language. Certainly, if the council desires to change or modify it, the city attorney sitting immediately to my left, I know he could comment as well if necessary. So,
Mike, do you want to talk now or after the speak now or after the public if they do speak?
Well, if the council has any specific questions, I'd be happy to answer them whenever they're posed.
Okay, let's open this up. It is a public hearing at this point. It's open. Anyone wishing to come forward from the public to address the proposal to approve a resolution to adopt the ordinance, which in this case is our ethics ordinance, which we've talked about for about 4 years now. No one seeming to come forward, so I'm going to close the public hearing, turn this over to council. And again, Mike Homier is here, the city attorney, if anyone has any questions about it. I had just thrown out the idea in case council wanted to discuss the penalties. The penalties are strict, and it is a new thing, so I just wanted council to consider that portion in particular. And it requires us all to be really up on our toes with regard to requirements that are now going to be required of not only us, but our employees as well. And I think our city attorney's on this one, too, as a person that needs to stay within our ethics.
Sorry about that, Mr. Mayor. I just was going to point out, that is an interesting point you bring up. I was going to mention, a lot of them do have the language like this, and I think part of the reason is that there's a couple public acts in Michigan that direct the same thing. So they may, this is another way of reinforcing and maybe making it more knowledgeable to people. There's a, I don't want to misstate, but I think there was at times was some questions on the public acts if they actually involve local officials, and there's been direction that says yes they do. So this has been an enforcement into it, which might, that may help in your concern of bringing up about it being right away, but knowing that the public acts already have it that way, it might give us a better okay to go forward with it. But with that said, I did want to thank the staff and the council and the city attorney for putting efforts on this. I know it's been over 4 years, and I know I've been harping on it for 4 years, not to all the council's liking, but I do think it sets the example. We put a standard on the public about making sure that they follow our ordinances and codes and public acts, and I think strong leadership is when we put ourselves out there and say we're also going to follow suit. And 4 years ago, this would have been nice. It may have helped a couple issues in 2009 be a little more clear, and this will help in that process. So I do thank you for taking this. I know it's been a long process, about 4 years and 5 months, so it's a good quality one. I also wanted to mention, at that time, they had some other ones that were brought up, but 4 years ago, we also had looked at the city of Bangor, DeWitt, Livonia, and a couple others, Warren, that have them. And I know last time the discussion came up, well, there's none in northern Michigan. The exciting thing is that we'll be at the front of that. Maybe that'll help encourage other units of government to do the same thing.
May I ask a question?
Sure.
Is there something specific, a specific incident in 2009 that you're referring to that we could have used something like this to help us get through? I think I'm looking for some examples of how this might affect us or the staff in our operations. Is anything going to change? Or, you know, I mean, nobody wants to put themselves out there. I've read it, but I would like maybe some examples of things that have been sticky wickets in the past that we need to have, you know.
Sure. Well, first, I think it helps clarify the conflicts of interest. These are all, again, part of the public acts. But I think in reference to 2009, I had addressed, I thought, possibly some conflicts of interest with a contracted, I don't know if I'm using the right term, not employees, but with their contracted employees, where we had with the well-fill process. It would have clearly stated a little more some of those conflicts that were addressed at the time. That's one example. This gets into other examples of, hopefully we don't have a lot in the past, but it helps prevent them in the future too, in terms of it addresses the issue of gifting. If you had a situation where somebody was looking for the city to vote on something and they started to gift or give money to a council member, those types of things. There's a lot of different processes that could come in. The other one they look at, the Public Act 196, talks a lot about, I don't think we've had this here, but you could have council members that are part of negotiating a contract, say for their business, or one that they had financial interest in, those types of things. So the good news is nothing in here is outside of what the public acts talk about.
I have another question. Sorry. When you talk about conflict of interest, you know, we have a charter that also has a section on conflict of interest. So how do the two of these gel? Or what supersedes what?
Well, if I try to jump in,
yeah.
And I might need to delegate this back to Mike, but I think for the most part, the ethics ordinance itself, to a degree, basically restates public act that already exists regarding ethics and gift banning, localizes it, or rather customizes it, to Cadillac. I don't believe it would run necessarily interference with our charter. If it does, then I would say Mike would need to opine on whether or not one trumps the other. But I think even if this ordinance didn't get implemented by this, or rather approved by the city council and then subsequently implemented, there are still these standards that exist with respect to state statute in which people can be punished accordingly. I think what this does is it brings a heightened awareness and then creates a specific process at the local level for handling issues or concerns if they come up. In fact, if you look at the section with respect to complaints, whether they're complaints for elected or appointed officers and officials or complaints regarding employees, there's a process that is being, you know, established as part of this ordinance that creates a hearing. So there's the opportunity for, you know, an investigation to take place before you would just automatically jump the gun and forward this on to a higher law enforcement level to investigate. You're actually kind of taking a whack at the bat first, if that makes any sense. But Mike, I guess the question back to you is, if there's an issue with respect to conflicts of interest that should get raised as a part of a potential violation of our ethics ordinance, given that the city charter does have that section, would one trump the other in this instance? Would you defer back to the charter, or would you look through, or would you go through the ethics ordinance process of trying to determine and investigate if such breach or violation did take place? And this is honestly something that it may have to be on a case-by-case basis. I don't know if Mike can opine right on the spot.
It just concerns me because we're using the same terminology in both places.
Well, as I recall, I don't have the specific section in front of me, but as I recall, the charter simply allows a member of the council to recuse themselves if they have a conflict, and the other council members vote to excuse that member. It doesn't necessarily define the conflict itself. So in what circumstances do you actually have a conflict? Certainly there are state statutes that define that in terms of contracts and other conduct, but I don't believe the city's charter really defines what conflicts are.
Thank you.
If the question as to, I suppose, a hierarchy would be that the charter would trump an ordinance if it conflicts, but I'm not certain that there's a conflict here.
And I think you're right in terms of what I remember, too, is they don't have any things that are on the same topic in our charter that would show up. This one doesn't address voting. This ordinance doesn't address voting like the charter does, and vice versa. We also have ordinances that I don't even know if any of them directly tie in conflicts or not.
Any other questions or discussion? Is there a motion? Are we ready to do a motion? Mr. Stevens, you want the honor?
Is there a public hearing and that's closed?
I did close that after no one stood up, and I formally closed the public hearing. Turn it over to council. You're welcome.
Yes, I would make a motion that we approve the resolution as presented to adopt ordinance number 2012-8, called the Ethics Ordinance.
Support.
All right, there's a motion and support. Any further discussion? Hearing none. Chris, could we please have a roll call?
Councilmember Malama?
Yes.
Jeffers?
Yes.
Bowman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried. Thank you very much, Council, and Councilmember Stevens for harping for 4 years. It was all worth it. Next up is a public hearing to consider the removal of Maple Hill Cemetery Board Member Delbert Packard for failing to attend scheduled meetings. This is a public hearing. I'm going to open the public hearing at this time and flop it over to Mr. Petcha. What do you have as a backdrop on this, please?
Chris, if you could give a little bit of the history. Long story short is the person moved out of town. But we didn't know that until somewhat recently. Chris, if you could.
Mr. Packard was first appointed in 2003. He was reappointed the last time in September of 2010. That is the last meeting he attended, and he never came in and got sworn in. And we have sent him cards, and we sent him this notice both places, to Cadillac, and we found out he's registered voter in South Haven, and we don't get any reply. We haven't heard anything. And the board is requesting that someone fill his shoes.
We have a two-member board now they're operating with. It should be three. Right. So they have to have perfect attendance?
Pretty much.
Yes. All right. Thank you, Chris. That is the same rundown I have been hearing, and that's why it's up for public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak regarding this item at this time, please come on forward. Seeing no one come forward, I'm going to close the public hearing. Turn this over to council. Council, how would you like to proceed?
I'd like to move forward with a motion to remove Delbert Packard from the Maple Hill Cemetery Board.
Okay, there's a motion. Is there support for?
Support.
Thank you. There is support. Any further discussion?
I just thought it might be good to mention that it sounds like more of a technicality and
right.
And that, you know, thank you probably, and maybe that could even be put in the letter informing him about this, to thank him for his time serving. It looks like he must have been part at least 7-8 years, and probably moving, that was something that didn't cross his mind, and so I want to make sure it's noted too that we appreciate the volunteerism on his part.
Okay, so we have a motion and support. Any further discussion? Hearing.
I can only appreciate that that board wanting to appoint someone else, because I truly believe attendance is extremely important. So I respect the board for wanting to get another person on there.
Thank you. Anything else? Hearing nothing else, Chris, could you please give us a roll call on this?
Councilmember Shippers?
Yes.
Bowman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Malama?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried. Next up, we have some communications. Chris?
We have a request from the Cadillac Festival of Races to close the Lakeside parking lot on Lake Street on Friday, August 31st at 5 p.m. for the parking of bikes for the next day.
Okay. Do you want to flesh that out at all, Marcus?
Sure, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council. We actually had this item before Council previously. However, recently we realized that the only closures that Council permitted were the street closures, and they do need the parking lot closed as well. So that's why this item has come before you again. Chris, do you recall when this was here before? This was a few months ago,
March,
wasn't it? Yeah, it was back here in March. So. Just a general housekeeping type of
okay.
item.
All right, any further discussion from council? Hearing none, could we please have a motion?
I move to approve the request from Cadillac Festival of the Races to close the Lakeside parking lot on Lake Street on Friday, August 31st at 5 p.m. for the parking of bikes.
Thank you.
Support.
Motion and support. Any further discussion? Hearing none, Chris, could we please have a roll call?
Councilmember Spolman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Malama?
Yes.
Shippers?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried. Not necessarily in that order. Next one, Chris.
We have another request from the Cadillac Rotary Club to close Lake Street between Harris and Cass Streets from 6 p.m. to 11 p.m. for a band concert on July 11th.
Mayor?
Yes.
Since I'm the individual that made that request on behalf of Rotary, I believe I should not be voting on this.
Okay. Are you getting paid for your services from Rotary? I'm going to bet
no, sir.
That you're not. I don't see it as a financial conflict or any conflict. What does council feel?
I don't see it as a conflict.
Mm-hmm. We've crossed this bridge. I appreciate you bringing that up. Very nice. And can you tell us again who the show is?
We're going to have Seth Bernard and Daisy May Bernard okay. on July 11th at the Rotary Pavilion. It's a Wednesday, and they're bringing in their full band.
Awesome.
Nice.
Okay. I don't have any objection, and it sounds like no one else does. Thanks for bringing that up. We would appreciate it if you vote, because it doesn't look like anyone's moving to disqualify you. With that, could we have a motion?
I move to approve the request from the Cadillac Rotary Club to close Lake Street between Harris and Cass from 6 p.m. to 11 p.m. on July 11th for a fabulous band concert.
All right.
Support.
That's a nice motion and support. Any further comments, questions, applause? Mm-hmm. Chris, could we have a roll call?
Councilmember Stevens?
Yes.
Malama?
Yes.
Shippers?
Yes.
Bowman?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried. It looks like, Marcus, our appointments moved up to the front of our meeting by chance?
They are.
Great.
They are.
Thanks for making that change.
You're welcome. I figured it would be a nice gesture for folks that are here just for appointments.
Okay. Chris, it looks like you're in charge of appointments tonight. Could you give us a rundown on what's happening?
Judy Coffey's term expires on July 19th, and it's recommended that she be reappointed. She has expressed an interest to continue to serve.
Okay, and this will be a 5-year term?
Yes.
I'll make a motion to reappoint Judy Coffey to the Cadillac Housing Commission for a 5-year term expiring July 19th, 2017.
Okay.
I will support that.
There's a motion and support from the right side, my right side. Any discussion, additional discussion about Judy or otherwise? You're the left side?
Yes, we are.
You are. Any further discussion? Politics.
Not politics, gender.
Okay, all right.
And politics.
There you go. Any discussion about Judy Coffey? I just saw her walking on Main Street enjoying the show. Back to the bricks. Looks like she was having fun.
She's somebody who contributes a lot to our community. I commend her for all of the places where she serves, this being one.
Yep. Ditto. Anything else, folks? Chris, let's get her on board.
Councilmember Malama?
Yes.
Jeffers?
Yes.
Bowman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried. Congratulations, Judy. Thanks again for serving. Welcome back for another 5-year term. Looks like you have one more, Chris.
Yes. In March, Charles Labar filled out an application to serve on the cemetery board. At the time, Dell was a member, so he had to wait. But he is still interested in filling Mr. Packard's term.
All right. Is Charles here tonight?
Yes, he is.
Hi, Charles.
Hi.
I'm pretty sure that was you. Would you like to say anything to us tonight?
I don't know what it's about, but I'm willing to give it a try. I'd like to know if there's any guidelines that I need to look at in order to find out what it's all about.
All right. I'm sure the city will help you with that. Mr. Ellenboss, or who would be helping him with that? The cemetery board?
Oh, yeah. Yes.
Brian?
Brian.
Okay.
Brian Ellenboss and or Al.
I know him good.
Do you mind? So, Bruce DeWitt, the director. We'll get you all the information you need.
Okay.
Thank you for applying and your patience as well so we could straighten this out. Folks, any discussion prior to a motion for Mr. Labar? Hearing none, could we have a motion?
Motion to appoint Charles Labar to the cemetery board to fill an unexpired term that expires on January 1st, 2014.
Okay.
Support.
There's a motion and support. Any further discussion?
Just a thank you to him and to note that it's an honor. There's only 3 of you and one of the best cemeteries in the state, by no question. It's a beautiful cemetery.
I will
agree
with the best cemetery in the state.
Well, he's got the right passion. Thanks again for applying, and hopefully we'll get you on here. Sounds like there's a motion and support. Anything else?
Goofy.
All right. Chris, could we please have a roll call to get Charles on board?
Councilmember Shippers?
Yes.
Bowman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Malama?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried. Congratulations, Charles. Thanks for serving. Somebody's going to be contacting him very shortly, either by phone or they'll mail you a packet. We have your address, and thanks for coming tonight as well. Next up would be our city manager's report. Mr. Pecha, looks like we've got some apple pie business here.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council. The first item is actually pretty exciting. We have a new business that I would like to locate in Cadillac along Mitchell Street in the shopping mall area off of Mitchell and River. The business is called Uncle Don's Apple Pie. Their intentions are to create an indoor distillery of spirits. They're going to have retail sales as well as a small sort of sampling or tasting area. In accordance, however, with the state of Michigan liquor application process that they have to go through, although the Cadillac City Council does not approve the liquor license, they do need the City Council to sign off on thinking that this is a good idea. So that's why this is before you this evening. I'm not sure if, Jerry, if you wanted to add or embellish anything to that.
No, essentially, in the council packet, what the council is being asked to do is to approve the application or the request that's been made tonight for the use of, in this case, 805 North Mitchell Street as the location of the distillery operation. You're not approving the liquor license, you're approving the location of this business. And the applicants are here tonight.
Okay. Uncle Don is in the house. Would you mind coming forward, saying hello to us and everybody in our TV land?
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome all of you to attend our little establishment. If you've never seen a still at work, you will. And ladies, you will enjoy, no, first thing, I can't say that. Gentlemen, if you take any of the Uncle Don's apple pies home, my country cocktails home, drink it first before you let the ladies have it, because if you don't, you'll never get any. Because I've had this told to me many times. This is my right-hand person, Jennifer Kingsley. She's the lady that keeps me straight on the computer, believe me. But we're looking forward to do business here. And the reason we're here is to get this approved, because the way the state has their liquor license, they will not let us have it until you approve the location. Then we send that to them. Then they send us our license, and we get a copy of our license for the city of Cadillac. And so, I mean, it's kind of a not quite culture, which your attorney might understand, the way the state handles things. Okay, smile here. So anyways, no further ado, I'd like to turn this over to Jennifer Kingsley, and she'll answer whatever questions you have.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Uncle Don. Hi, Jennifer.
Hi.
What would you like us to know, if anything, before we maybe throw some questions your way? Maybe not.
Go ahead and ask away.
Okay. Council, Jennifer's presenting herself to, availing herself to any questions we
so
may have.
This is just a distillery and retail sales. Are you going to be, there won't be a place to sit down and...
Correct.
Like serve the...
Correct. It'll be $5 for four samples, and it's standing only. We'll have a couple of like benches. If you have to wait in line or anything like that, you'll have a bench you can sit on, but there's no tables, no chairs, like table and chair sets. It's just standing room only, pretty much.
Not a bar.
Correct.
Not a bar. Can you tell us a little bit more about what you're distilling?
We distill our own vodkas, and then we create a mix, which is the country cocktails, and the vodka that he produces goes into the mix, and then that's what our country cocktail is.
And what do you use to distill the vodka?
We use, we've used several different, but the one we like is the potato vodka.
Russian vodka.
And our still is small. It's only a 27-gallon still right now, so we're not... Mm. We're still the mom and pop size store.
Interesting. It is interesting.
I don't know if you'll know the answer to this, but I know there's a couple of the different kinds of licenses. One that they limit more, and then the other one that's more open.
That's us. We're the small distillery. We're only allowed to make 50,000 gallons of our own vodka a year. We can make no more than that.
I didn't even know they had that rule. But I didn't know. Is this one that... Some they only allow so many jurisdictions, a certain type of them, and then they have the other kind where it's less limiting?
That I don't know. Do you know that?
Yeah. What it is, what you're talking about is like a bar license and that. So many licenses for the area. But under a small distillery or even a large distillery, you could have 30 of them here in Cadillac. Okay. And it's not going to bother anything. But.
Right.
So
we have to approve the location.
Yes.
Correct.
Thank you.
And this location is 805. Where is that?
It's right next door. Yeah.
Oh.
In Sherwin-Williams.
Walking distance.
And that's the best way to travel if you come visit us.
That's a lot of samples.
Okay.
Okay, other than the fact that we just signed or agreed to an ethics ordinance, I would say we should all go down there. No.
I think Jerry has it.
I just want to mention that they have been working with the DK Design Group with respect to the interior modifications, as well as they've been working with the county building inspector. So they've already gone through the process of meeting with those folks and working with those folks to develop the plans for the renovations needed for the building.
I do have copies.
Can you guess at why the State Liquor Control Commission has local municipalities approve location? What types of things are we supposed to consider here?
It primarily, I talked to the state, primarily it's just to make sure they're consistent with zoning.
Okay.
And they are.
That's it.
Yes. Anyone else with any other questions? I know they didn't bring free samples with them tonight.
They're not up and running till they have that license.
Correct.
Thank you.
That's not the usual still that we're familiar with in this region. My wife's relatives in Harrietta, out by Harry, were famous for this in the 40s and 50s, I think. So it's nice to see. Yeah, I think there probably were some. I'll take a look, but it's nice to see you going through the legal steps, and welcome to our community. I certainly hope this passes for you and that
thank you.
This works out.
And I'd like to make a motion to approve the request for a small distiller's license for 805 North Mitchell Street.
Support.
Okay, motion and support. Any other comments? And we'll ask for a vote. Chris?
Councilmember Spolman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Malama?
Yes.
Shippers?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried. Good luck, Uncle Don and Jennifer. Don and Jennifer, thank you for coming, and congratulations, and hopefully you'll get the rest of your paperwork in order.
Thank you.
All right. We'll come down and visit. Okay, things are going too well tonight. Marcus, what do you have next for us?
Don't jinx us.
Yeah, really.
the next item, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council, is regarding the sale of city-owned property. The city was approached by a resident at 250 Granite Street with the desire to purchase 248 Granite Street. The site is vacant, and I do see that Mr. Adams has put on an overhead. What we're here this evening for is basically to get council's permission to draft a bid notice, put it in the newspaper accordingly for the sale of this parcel. Otherwise, the city would just retain ownership. Jerry, did you have a presentation that you wanted to give on this?
No.
Okay. I'll just keep going then. Staff does not have a concern with respect to selling this parcel, which is one of the reasons why it, of course, is before you this evening for consideration. As you can tell, the lot is surrounded by other single-family dwellings and homes. According to the resident that approached the city asking to purchase it, he did advise that for a number of years he's been maintaining that lot, and it's basically his desire to combine the vacant lot with his lot currently located at 250 Granite in order to increase the size and the value of his parcel and his residence. We did advise him that, you know, the sale of the property would require council approval, and again, that's what we're asking for this evening.
Thank you, Mr. Petcha. Mm-hmm. Council, would you like to proceed here? And it looks like we do need a motion to put it in the paper.
Quick question. Do we know the history of how the city obtained this? Was this one of those that was through a sale or deeded to the city for any reason?
Or a foreclosure?
How long has the city owned it?
Looks like you
I
have
don't know. Jerry, do you have?
I don't know. We have nothing, you know, nothing in the immediate future that would, you know, give us an indication. It's my understanding we've owned it for a number of years.
And there's no building or structure currently on the site, so if it was through some form of a tax sale, whatever structure's there is, it's no longer there, it's just a vacant lot.
Which property is Mr. Purpose?
To the, on that map, he would be to the left.
Okay, we should be thanking him for upkeeping our city property.
I'd say, before we send the bid notice out, we'll look to see if there's something on the paperwork and the deed, and if there is, we'll bring it back to council before issuing it.
It's probably a safe move, because I know there was some that were deeded with certain...
Restrictions
on it. This probably not is one, but I know in some other areas, and just out of curiosity.
Yeah, and mowing the lawn and everything.
Any questions, either side here? Or the middle? Okay, appreciate a motion to get it, the bid notice. Marcus, actually, by the way, I assume that anyone could purchase this or bid on it in the city? And that's how it works. Obviously, one person is very interested in... Okay.
I'll make a motion to approve the placement of a bid notice in the Cadillac News informing the public of the parcel's potential availability along with bidding instructions.
Okay, thank you, Sherry. And is there a support for Sherry's motion?
Support.
There is. Okay, we'll give that to Councilmember Melama.
It was a tie, but he...
Yeah, my left ear must work better than my right. Any other discussion? Drummers. Could we have a roll call, please, Chris?
Councilmember Stevens?
Yes.
Melama?
Yes.
Dippers?
Yes.
Coleman?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried. Good luck, bidders. And next up, Mr. Petcha, looks like you're on deck here.
On a roll.
You're on a roll.
A few more left. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council. The next item we had put as a placeholder update on city public safety millage. As the City Council knows, about a month or so ago, the Council has approved the language that was transferred over to the county for the purposes of placing a public safety millage language on the upcoming August primary ballot. Councilmember Stevens and Councilmember Melama, over quite a period of time, went and spent a lot of time meeting with county officials to try to work things out with the county with respect to trying to obtain additional services, public safety related services from the Sheriff's Department. I put this on the agenda tonight. There isn't necessarily any action for the council to take, but more or less is an opportunity for the council to consider perhaps moving forward again with another reach out, sharing the ballot language that the council has recently put together, sharing with the county the objectives that the council has discussed as far as reasons as to why, and basically moving the item forward again, presumably with Councilmember Stevens and Melama leading the charge. So,
okay, well, that would be great. What do you recommend? Do we take action tonight? Just form a consensus, or
consensus is basically what I was looking for. Again, I figured that it could be a good opportunity to tickle the issue again. Certainly, if there's any need for me or anyone else to get involved, we're here as necessary. But I really think that this could be a good chance to reach out again, extend another olive branch, and see where it flies.
Okay. Have we heard anything from the department or the county in general since we put our millage out there, at least for discussion and then passage by council?
I have not heard anything. I don't know if council person Stevens has, but I haven't heard anything. Except through several commissioners that they're aware that we have gone ahead with our own ballot language. And I have reiterated to them that, and I have said this publicly, and I'll say it again, the door is open. Mm-hmm. We are more than willing to talk. As you know, communications is a two-way street. And we are more than willing to sit down with the Wexford County Commissioners and to discuss on our mutual interests and how we can support each other. More than willing. But once again, I'll come back to the point that it's very difficult to just talk to yourself and not have another party that you can talk to. But the door is open. The door will be open all the way through, even through August or past August, whatever needs to happen. But once again, I'll reach out again to Wexford. We will reach out, excuse us, all of us, and willing to talk with them. We are putting a blue ribbon panel together. Letters will go out. We are gearing up to, because we have needs in the community. We have needs in the city, I should say. Mm-hmm. And once again, that's where we're at with this issue. It's something that it's not a direction we wanted to go. Mm-hmm. We wanted to work together with our services because we have mutual interests. But I come back to the point that it's communications, 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 and we are open. Yeah.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, slightly different topic, similar similar concept, though, with respect to reaching out. I have also not yet heard back from Herring Township regarding a request on the extension of the sewer agreement, which is why we have not yet had it back on our agenda. And you just reminded me, Mr. Mayor, when you had mentioned about do we hear anything as to letting you know about communications. So letting everybody know here all at the same time, you know, that offer is still out there, and certainly if they choose to come back to us, as we, you know, we had asked, if they want to talk about it and let us know their feelings on it, we'll certainly bring it back for consideration. In fact, as you may or may not have caught in the correspondence that I had sent out, I listed, you know, a variety of dates for a couple of our upcoming meetings when our packets typically get, you know, get published and when they go out, so when various deadlines would be. So if they wanted to come forward with us to have us consider that extension to the contract, we would know, you know, ideally in a period of time to get it on the agenda, so it wouldn't be a, you know, kind of like a last minute, you know, add-on. So, but just figured might as well opine on that really quick or offer information on that really quick.
But I would be willing to reach out to the Wexford County chairman, and once again, okay, I'll do that. That's not a problem.
And I can get you a copy of the ballot, okay, which
I'd be more than willing to.
And we should note that the on the operational end, the Under Sheriff Taylor has expressed openness to meet with us as well.
So get her going. Will do. All set with
all
that?
Set.
Anything over here on the millage, folks? Public safety? Any discussion tonight? All right, Marcus, keep it rolling.
Thank you. Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council, the next three items, actually, Owen is going to help provide some backup. Owen, did I mention that earlier tonight?
I was ready.
You were ready. Okay.
Yep. Read your mind.
we'll take them. We'll take them all separately, but they're all with respect to recent bids that came back. The first one is regarding our workers' compensation insurance. We received a bid back from the Michigan Municipal League in an amount of $64,432. It is our recommendation that our workers' compensation insurance do come from the Michigan Municipal League Workers' Compensation Fund in accordance with their proposal. I'm not sure if there's any questions on what that is, or if Owen, if you wanted to add anything to that.
No, very straightforward. We've been with the league for a lot of years on this one, and I believe 2 or 3 years ago we got another bid that wasn't really close to this one that the league is able to offer on this, on the workers' comp side. Kind of the same deal on the liability and property insurance side to address these both at the same time. We're getting basically for the last several years such a good a good rate from Cadillac Insurance through their companies that this year we didn't get even any other bids. So
we did have some inquiries, though.
We had a couple inquiries, but then no one followed through with a bid. So one thing that I was going to ask the council to consider was even a multi-year award for this purchase. We're not going to obviously have concrete numbers.
Which one are you talking about, the workers' comp?
Well, both, these two insurance. Based on the history of the bids that we've gotten, we didn't put that in the write-up, but thought I would ask just to throw it out there. The bid process does take some time. It costs some money to advertise in the paper. And I think if we did it every couple of years or even every third year, that would provide the same type of benefit at less cost overall and a greater efficiency. So
next time around, you're referring to?
Well, could do it this time, basically, on just awarding it for multiple years or not, whatever.
All right.
Oh, and if they would lock in the same price or the same rate?
They would not. No. I specifically asked that of the liability insurance, and they're just not able to predict. A lot of these things are based on experience, loss experience, claims experience, both of which we've had several successful years in a row. So,
well, it's nice, too, in both of these, the first two, I recall the liability and property insurance, I think when we did do that bidding, it was about $54,000.
We saved about a third, yeah.
And yep. So it's probably, even though you're doing the competitive bidding, I mean, if they're in that ballpark that low,
exactly.
What's nice is when we bid that, we save, it's not just one year we're saving that $54,000, it's every year.
Year over year, yep.
Could we, if we were to entertain that, could we have, is it acceptable to put something in there that if the increase was over a certain percentage, we then would
absolutely
maybe go after bids
to throw a threshold in there in your motion to say award the purchase for the next 3 years unless the annual increase rate quote is in excess of 10% or something like that. Would be, that's fine by me. I mean, Mike, you have any concerns with that, or should we think about that for the next time and just do the 1 year now? Or
yeah, to the extent that it was, I presume that it was bid out as a 1 year. Is that right? Or was there any qualifying limitation on it?
It was bid out as 1 year simply because last time we asked for like a 5 year and they're not able to give numbers. So it was only awarded for a year.
Maybe someone would have seen it, if it would have been for two or three, maybe they would have bid where they wouldn't bid for one.
Or it could have affected the price somehow on the bids itself. So
sounds like we're waiting until next year.
That's fine. We'll try and build it into the proposal next year.
All right. That sounds good. Thank you for letting us know that. Could we have is there any discussion on our workers' comp insurance bid, or could we have a motion to award that to the MML?
I would like to make a motion to award the contract for workers' compensation insurance for fiscal year 2013 to the Michigan Municipal League in accordance with their proposal.
Thank you.
Support.
And support. We have a motion and support. Any further discussion on the workers' compensation insurance? Hearing none. Chris, could we please have a roll call?
Councilmember Melama?
Yes.
Shippers?
Yes.
Bowman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried. And Mr. Roberts, talk to us about the comprehensive liability and property insurance as well. This would be going to Cadillac Insurance Center.
Yep.
Anything else you wanted to add on?
No,
that?
Same thing. Yep.
Okay. Thank you. So that's a nice bid again from them. They were again the only bidder. Is that right, Mr. Roberts?
That's correct. Yep.
Okay. So
motion to award the contract for comprehensive liability and property insurance to Cadillac Insurance Center for $106,308.
Okay, thank you.
Support.
There's support. Any further discussion on the liability insurance bid for property? Hearing none. Chris, could we please have a roll call?
Member Shippers?
Yes.
Bowman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Milama?
Yes.
Mayor Burnett?
Yes. Motion carried. Next victim, Marcus.
Thank you. Opportunity. Next opportunity is request regarding computer network and information technology support services. This is a request to award a five-year contract essentially for IT support services to, and I think the spelling is perhaps wrong, it's called IT, no it's not, to IT Wright of Bath, Michigan. There is a table that is part of your packet, and I'm just going to open it up here. There were 11 bids that were submitted, including a bid by our current contractor. As you'll notice in the table, for the most part, all of the contractors are essentially kind of clumped somewhat together. I mean, there is some disparity between pricing, but they're not necessarily nearly as disparate as IT Wright is. We did bring them in. They were the lowest bidder by a long shot. We did bring them in. We made sure that they were the real deal. They have a tremendous amount of municipal experience. Owen and I met with the owner of the company. I questioned them. Owen questioned them even with more detail. And we're very encouraged and excited to offer glamour shots. Let me look at you first. You should see the last one.
It's Rick's fault.
Looks like my nose is up to the spot. So we're very encouraged. We're very excited to give this company an opportunity. Owen, I know you can add a tremendous amount with respect to their technical capabilities and so forth. We physically showed them our network equipment and our various sites to make sure that we weren't going to be getting into our contract with someone that necessarily was biting off more than they could chew, but we really felt confident that they'll do us right. So.
Okay. I recall we had a large argument over this about in February of 2011.
Yes, we did.
And you waited to bid it out and finished the studying. There was some study regarding the clouds. I just want to give you an article I found somewhere, Marcus, in case you're really bored.
But it was in
It was in one of our city county magazines that we get.
Thank you.
I found myself reading in the middle of the night, and there's the.
You must have been really bored.
Yes, but. We were looking at a cloud system for a number of months, and I appreciate very much this thing being bid out.
Mr. Mayor, we still are. In fact, that was part of the conversation that we had with this group, and they did offer that they have the technical expertise to help us migrate certain services over to the cloud if that's the direction that we really want to push. So.
And my point was we did want to bid this out, and that was where we had a standstill. It did get bid out, and I think Owen negotiated a lower fee in the meantime, and now we find that by bidding it out, we're down to 12,000. And what was the number at that time? Do you recall, Owen?
Well, the month-to-month we were going was about six times that. So
okay, so we're basically 80,000-90,000 a year.
Yeah, mid-70s.
This is a huge savings.
This is also. Is this the same company the county uses?
The new company is, yeah.
As it was brought to us by a citizen about that time, too. Why aren't you using Wexford County's? Of course, we were looking at that as apples and oranges, but I guess we were good to look into this. I think it was Mr. Maxwell who came and told us that we were paying too much, but we've saved $70,000 or so by bidding this out. So congratulations to council for pushing for a bid process and the citizens that came forward.
This is a big change for the city, and I too appreciate you going through this and being open to doing this. And if anybody in the public could see this table, they would see how many different companies bid on this in many, many different ways. So This is a very competitive field. I personally have had the opportunity to work with IT Wright in two of the counties I work in, and I've had nothing but amazing experience with them. They're very good. And I know that, you know, desktop networking type of things, issues are not the same as large networking and security issues. But I think that, you know, as you figured out through the interview process, that they are totally capable. Obviously, they're a very aggressive company because they're getting contracts all over the place. More and more, mostly county governments, well, that's what I deal with mostly, are going to them and being very pleased with the types of services that they're able to bring to the county at a relatively good price. I hope it works out well for us.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Mayor, members of the council, I wanted to add that, assuming that the City Council will consider the approval of this, to please bear in mind, and for the public as well, to be patient, there will certainly be a transitional period when companies move in, move out, that kind of thing. Not that I expect our systems to go down necessarily, but it's possible that if a system or two do happen to go down, for whatever the reason might be, it might take a little bit longer to get things back up again, only because we're going to be swapping people in and out. I expect it to be smooth, but who knows? So,
can I ask a question?
Yes.
The current company we have is Terrapin, and there's another one. There's a times two, a multiplier of two, question mark. Their bid was $34,500, which is probably half of what they are charging us now.
Yeah, that was based on some semantics in that line of the proposal. It asked for an annual amount, but then it said payable biannually in advance. So, I think it was read as by a couple as put in what would be paid biannually.
Okay.
Because the other asked for what would be paid monthly. So.
And that's the biannual amount.
And it calculated out. So.
So that was 76. $79,000, actually.
$69,000,
thank you. That's my math. Good thing you're here for us.
Right. Like I said, Mr. Mayor, members of the council, if you just scan down that list, yeah. I mean, you've got 80, 60, 50, 82 almost. Then you've got, you know, the 70, another one at 86 almost, 72, and then one at 12. So, you know, they're all basically grouped within a somewhat close proximity to one another, except for the one that we're recommending tonight, which, you know, when you go through, and you, especially when you're looking at buying commodities, you kind of look at the one way up on top and the way on the bottom, and you say, well, those guys perhaps may not necessarily have gotten, you know, the bid spec right. Maybe there's something off, and you look at where people are grouping in the middle. But here, I think we are getting lucky.
So. I think Art was giving me a hard time on this one. I think I went along with his lead back then, but he wanted staff to bid it out, and I don't remember who else did, but thank you for harping.
I thought this was a good learning lesson, because that was 2 years ago. There was four members present. There was some discussion about bidding it out. There was a 2-2 vote to not give it to Terrapin. The mayor and I, we did get a council member specifically stated, and I think this is good to hear, because it is a lesson. At the time, I know it was putting it that a lot of effort by Owen, which he did put a lot. Owen put a phenomenal amount in, but at the time it was stated, it's highly cost effective if the purpose of bidding out contracts is to make things cost effective. I find that after hours of negotiating with a company that is saving us tons of thousands of dollars in new contract and dismiss the amounts of work and brain hours that were used to put the bid together, that is not required by law or by rationality to be rebid. I think that it is an exercise of taking to extreme what one feels is important. I think it is important to bid things out, but that the ones that will save the city money, and also this disrespects the amount of time that staff and Terrapin put into this. But I think this did put some hours into Owen, but that type of a savings is worth the bidding, even if it takes, I don't think it would have, but if it took him 40 hours, that type of savings is worth it. And I know, Owen, thank you for all your time to doing this bid. And I know you had to do a lot of follow-up. Fortunately, this would be a good surprise for us in terms of budgets. And I think it's kind of like the liability. What's important is it's not just 1 year. That savings will be annually for a while.
Five.
So I know, Mayor, you get hit a lot of times, we as a council, about maybe on one project how we are wasting funds. But sometimes these things get overlooked about how we're going to save some dollars here. And at this time, this kind of a budget, what Owen did and the staff, it's commendable of making this happen.
It's like five free years.
This is truly going to help us. There's a lot of deferred projects in that IT fund that this will help us start moving along with.
Great. Any other discussion on the topic, or could we do a motion and support and get this thing locked in?
I'd make a motion that we award to IT Wright of Bath, Michigan, in accordance with the proposal that was submitted by the company, the contract going from July 1st, 2012 to June 30th, 2017.
Support.
Any discussion? Hearing none. Chris, please a roll call.
Councilmember Spolman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Milama?
Yes.
Shippers?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried. Thank you, Council. And staff, excellent job. That's, I think, one of the best savings we've ever had in the five-ish years that I've been here. Actually, the first 4 years back in the 90s as well. Amazing. Okay, Marcus, we're up to ordinances and resolutions, and we've got some tonight.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council. The first one is an introduction of an ordinance for the lease agreement with respect to the Wexford County Historical Society and Museum. Traditionally, in the past, at the time that we set the public hearing, these documents would have been prepared and ready for you to consider. However, at the last council meeting, they were not. Therefore, we're bringing them forward tonight accordingly. But the public hearing has already been set. It's for July 16th, 2012.
Okay. Could we have a motion to approve the resolution, which would introduce the ordinance for a lease agreement with the Historical Society?
I move to approve the resolution to introduce an ordinance for a lease agreement with the Wexford Historical Society and Museum and to set a public hearing for July 16th, 2012.
Thank you, T.I. Motion is out there. Is there support for T.I.'s motion?
Support.
There is support. Any further discussion?
Just a question. If we've already set the public hearing, why are we setting it again?
We're not. We already set the public hearing. I think that might be a misprint on your
blue copy. So do I need to not?
Okay, well, let's slow down then. Hang on. I do recall we had a meeting on this. This came up in the past.
Right. Mike, would it be appropriate to just simply have a motion to approve the resolution, introduce an ordinance for a lease agreement with Wexford County Historical Society?
Did we actually set the public hearing last time? I know they requested it on that date.
Yes.
And we set it.
Yes, and the resolution is just to introduce the ordinance approving the lease agreement.
And we are using the... Oh, I'm sorry.
So I could amend it to not include set a public hearing?
That's correct.
Okay. I would like to offer that amendment.
Okay. And is there that kind of support with that amendment in mind as well?
Support.
Thank you.
Nice catch.
Thank you for being on your toes. Was that Sherry?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to keep you all straight. You know?
Yeah. You're one of those. You've come from the UP today, so.
I'm so tired.
Welcome to my day as well. Okay. Any discussion? Hearing none. Chris, could we please vote on the amended motion?
Councilmember Stevens?
Yes.
Milama?
Yes.
Shippers?
Yes.
Spolman?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried. Congratulations, Wexford County Historical Society and Museum.
Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council, the next item is, again, the introduction of an ordinance vacating a public alley, similar to what we did with just a moment ago with the Wexford County Historical Society. We've already set the public hearing, so this blue copy that you have in front of you that shows the action, just delete the last part of that, but the motion tonight would be to approve the resolution to introduce an ordinance to vacate a public alley near 1202 North Mitchell Street. This is, again, with respect to the CW, the former CWTA operational property.
Okay. This was the one that we were going to do on July 2nd, or is there something still?
Yes, this was the one that we're going to do on July 2nd. There was some discussion at the last meeting about the timing, about whether we were going to have a meeting on the 2nd or not, and whether or not there was any conflict with respect to their timing, but the council did determine at the last meeting to have the public hearing on July 2nd.
Okay. Okay, I would entertain a motion at this time.
And again, Mr. Mayor, members of council, similar to the last one, simply cross out that last part of the motion. The motion would be to approve the resolution to introduce an ordinance to vacate a public alley near 1202 North Mitchell Street.
Okay. Motion, please.
I'll make a motion that we approve the resolution to introduce an ordinance to vacate the public alley near 1202 North Mitchell Street.
Okay. Is there support?
Support.
There is support. Any further discussion?
Just one point of clarification. I know this may seem a little odd in the way it was done, but because of the way, under your charter, there's no real time commitment with respect to setting the public hearing, which is why you could set the public hearing. But there is a time frame for introducing the ordinance and then publishing notice of the public hearing, where notice is required in these instances twice, 20 days and 10 days prior to the public hearing. So even though the public hearing's been set, we publish notice first, 20 days in advance of that public hearing, and now we're introducing the ordinance within the time frame under the code, and we will publish notice again at least 10 days prior to the public hearing. So there will be another notice of public hearing published, but you've already set the public hearing, if that, hopefully that clears things up.
Hopefully. This, all the purple is being, or is it just that little strip?
The purple
that's being vacated.
No, it's just a little strip that runs north and south.
Okay.
Through the building.
It's still purple.
All right. Thank you.
I want to say again that I'm really disappointed that we're having a meeting on July 2nd, and it's going to be a huge inconvenience for me to attend that meeting. I've just found out my son's going to be here with his girlfriend, and he's in the Marines, and he's got to go to training in Quantico, and it's the only time he can be with me is that week. And I was afraid that was going to happen. It's a holiday week. We had the opportunity to have this later in the month, and we need 4 votes. And it's not that I don't support this in any way, shape, or form. It's just really bad timing.
We could actually have the public hearing. We don't have to vote on it at that night, do we, Mike?
No, there's nothing that requires you to vote on it that night.
Okay, so we could have the public hearing, and if there aren't 4 here, we'll understand that there won't be a vote. And we'll vote next time. We'll have held the hearing, and everybody will be kosher.
That'll work for me.
Okay. Maybe we could notify the folks involved that probably is going to be the situation.
I'll contact their lawyer.
Yeah. Peter Lauren.
Peter Doran.
Doran, thank you. Yep. I think that's an actor.
Wilson.
So attorneys are actors anyway, mostly.
They're likely not going to have a problem because they're seeking alternative service anyways, and so
okay.
It's not going to be a timing issue.
Okay, does that work
if you hear that it's a timing issue, please make sure you let me know.
I will.
So I think we're okay to set the public hearing as we've proceeded forward, so there is a some flexibility for you. That was, by the way, I would note it is a regularly scheduled meeting, and those are the ones we are supposed to be here for, but I understand that doesn't always work for families and the rest of our extended people we live with and enjoy seeing. With that, do we need anything else, Marcus or Michael? Did you cover everything?
I did.
Okay.
Just for the voting.
Okay. Chris, could we have a roll call vote?
Councilmember Miller?
Yes.
Shippers?
Yes.
Bowman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Mayor Burnett?
Yes. Motion carried. Marcus, looks like we have an adoption of an ordinance.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council. This next item, is a request for the adoption of an ordinance that will set a public hearing for July 2nd, 2012, to consider a request from Metal Punch Corporation for an industrial facilities tax exemption certificate in the amount of $276,300 for machinery and equipment. There is an, I don't know if you want to call it an addendum, but there's a sheet that was put in front of everyone, everyone's chairs this evening that has the equipment list with the dates of installation, with the sort of description as to what they are. It's grinding-related equipment. There's also a gentleman here this evening from Metal Corp. If there's any questions, however, at this time, again, council is simply being asked to set the public hearing for July 2nd, 2012.
Okay. Is anyone present tonight from Metal Punch? Would they wish to speak, or would you mind coming forward? Sorry about that. We have a mic there. That way folks back home can hear you. If you could tell us who you are and your position.
My name is Larry Roderick, and I'm with Metal Punch. I'm the manufacturing vice president, and just wanted to pass on this. This machinery is allowing us to be a lot more competitive in the world market. Already it's made some differences in what we're getting out of Mexico, Canada, and the attraction to this type of machinery, which is very, very precise. And it's just opening some new windows for us. We hired another new man today. So it's, and if somebody with the right qualifications, we'll hire him tomorrow. So that's how active this has made our business, and it's just going to continue. So.
Okay, is that a tool and die position there, or?
It's precision manufacturing of tool and die components.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, hopefully someone will be watching tonight that needs a job. We'll contact you tomorrow.
Okay, very good.
As long as this passes, and I guess we won't know that right away. We have a pretty good batting average with IFTs, but thank you, Larry. Anyone with any questions for Larry now that he sat down? Okay, good. That's good. Can we entertain a motion, or is there discussion?
I just wanted to mention, I just mentioned to the city manager that both of us went to Metal Punch about a year ago, mm-hmm. I believe it was, and things, of course, have definitely turned around since 2008 and 2009. Those were desperate times. Metal Punch has been in the community for quite a while. Great place to work, real stable workforce. It's kind of a sought-after place as far as in the tool and die profession. You have diversified. That gives you far more stability, am I correct? And you're into making all sorts of different types of new, you're in new lines. Do you want to mention that a little bit?
Because a lot of our lines, what it is it's getting us into and away from more of the automotive industry and into the HVAC, which is very high precision. Components with air conditioning, and every computer has a cooling system, and it's all part of that cooling system. As we pointed out into the newspaper, how precise this is, to put it in layman's term, and if you take any one of the gentlemen's hairs off your head, split it 1,000 times, that's how precise this has to be. When this finished product is done, if you hold it in your hand, you can't put it together. It's that precise. Just the heat from your hands will not allow you to put it together. So, and that's what's part of the cooling systems in the computers. And as we know, computers are changing daily. So that's what's, that's our focus, and that's where we're headed.
Great.
Interesting.
Yep, very interesting. Thank you, Larry.
Thank you.
With that, could we have a motion to adopt the resolution and get that hearing set for July 2nd?
I'll make a motion to adopt the resolution as presented that sets the public hearing for July 2nd, 2012 to consider the request from Metal Punch Corporation for an industrial facilities tax exemption certificate in the amount of $276,300.
Support. Support. There's motion and support. Any discussion? Hearing none. Chris?
Councilmember Shippers?
Yes.
Bowman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Melama?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried. Thank you, and thanks again, Larry. Good luck with your business, and tell everyone, keep it up. Glad to hear you're hiring. It's really good news. No reports of boards and commissions. We have some minutes from the DDA, the Rotary Pavilion Master Plan, and Diggins. Anything in there, Marcus, noteworthy for the audience tonight?
Nothing specific. Just, you know, wanted to mention that things are still moving along. There's been some dirt that's moved over at the Diggins Hill location regarding a shelter to be constructed. Rotary Pavilion Master Planning Committee are meeting again. So that'll be some rather exciting new development happening at that location as time goes on and plans start to get formalized. But nothing really to note.
Okay, thank you. Next up is public appearances, also known as public comment in disguise. Anyone wishing from the public wants to come? Harry. Come on forward, Harry. I'm just going to cut off. It doesn't happen often. I don't know. Hopefully it's not about the distillery from Harrietta.
Hey, they're going to ruin my whole speech here. Harry Elkman Boone, council members. I see we got a closed session here. Apparently, the city attorney does his best talking at a in these closed sessions, and you know, I can keep secrets. And I promise that you tell me these secrets, I won't tell nobody but McCready.
Very good. Yeah. That's known as public appearances number one, Harry Youngman from Boone. And we'll have to consider bringing him in for the closed sessions.
So moved.
Up with that promise. Anyone else? Public comment? It's open. I saw Mr. Champion enjoying the event tonight. Looked like a lot of fun down there. He was on the move. No tabled items. I'm closing public appearances, by the way. No tabled items. Go to the order. We'll start from our city manager's side of the table, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council. Just wanted to briefly, publicly thank all of my members of staff. We are, whether we realize it or not, this is the last meeting in our current fiscal year. The next meeting will be effectively fiscal year 2013. We've had challenges and opportunities, and I just would like to, although Owen and Chris and Jerry are the only few staff folks here this evening, would like to thank everybody for working with me, for working with council. I'd like to thank council for all of their hard work as well. You know, it's never a dull moment, and we're moving forward. We've got a lot of great topics that we've been working through, and I'm looking forward to jumping headfirst into 2013 in July 2012. Also wanted to just simply thank, yes, if you follow the dates, just simply thank the public safety folks and the volunteer CERT team that works through the Wexford County Emergency Operations Department. You know, there was the big Back to the Bricks event today. First ever closing down Mitchell Street. You know, you could plan all day long for activities like this, but until it actually happens and you have to work on the fly, as for instance, there's a semi-truck from Baker that was used to close off Mitchell and Pine. That wasn't part of the original thought until it actually came down today, and police and members of the CERT team said, hey, you know what, would you mind if we used your truck and just put it across the roadway? So is that kind of...
It's a good visual.
Yes.
On the, get through there.
Right, exactly. You know, on your toes thinking that it really worked out. So kudos to that to those organizations.
Okay. Councilmember Melama.
Just a couple things. My wife and I attended the Progressive Dinner, and that was very, very good. It was very well attended. Saw a lot of people, a lot of compliments, a lot of comments, I should say, about the sculptures. It was very interesting watching people. It's sort of like watching people in the produce department pick out a cantaloupe. You have shakers, you have sniffers, and then you have smellers. and people with the sculptures, they were feeling and touching, and they were looking at it and taking pictures, so it was very interesting to watch them use all their senses in evaluating the sculpture. Wonderful car show today, great crowd, really appreciate that. Then something that's city-related, our Cadillac Area Manufacturers Association has been around since 1949, and we have always been volunteers, and we're putting together a purchasing consortium that's made up of, we offered it to all of our CAMA members in the region, Traverse City and all over, and we are putting together a purchasing consortium, and insurance is going to be our first one. And we have hired our first part-time individual, and we're going to, this individual will be working as the director or as the purchasing consortium employee. And the savings that the companies have will be, a percentage of that will be kicked back to pay for this particular individual. And we've already had companies from Grand Haven all over that want to participate, and other associations, Jackson and Lansing, Jackson and Lansing down in that area. So, yeah, it's a milestone, our first employee, instead of having all of us volunteers. So it sounds kind of good to all of us.
Thank you. Councilmember Stevens?
Wanted to just echo the downtown look great, all the people on a weekday, and on a Monday, that many people downtown was awesome. It's nice to see those activities. And it's nice to be part of something. This is the first, like you said, other than a parade, where we've closed down Mitchell Street like that. So just wanted to say thank you to the staff and all. Good fiscal year. Appreciate, like Marcus said, the staff time. And just wanted to quickly let the council know, Councilmember Shippers and Marcus and a few staff members met with three of the townships to talk about the sewer discussion around Lake Mitchell. Phenomenal meeting. And I thought that was an excellent meeting, and I think you're going to probably in the near future, hopefully it will be exciting news as to looking at how we're going to handle that. We're meeting again in July, so excellent time. I wanted to let the council know in case you might have been planning on saying that, but just so that I know.
All right, Art, you're part of that committee as well?
Yes.
Okay, good job. You all set?
Yes, sir.
Hearing Township, Marcus, you indicated there was a deadline. We've given them one deadline. Did you give them a second deadline to respond in case they weren't able to by the first one, and have both those deadlines passed, or just one?
Just one.
The other one's toward the end of this month?
Yeah, I don't have the letter in front of me, Mr. Mayor, or members of council, but I believe what I did was I laid out in the letter how our meeting schedule works and when our agendas go out, which are typically the Thursdays before, the week before our Monday meetings, and said that, in order to get something on the agenda and have it prepared and up there versus adding it kind of last minute, we really need to have things by that Wednesday before at the latest, or certainly by Thursday morning. But I think I put it the Wednesday before, and I threw out dates for our next couple of meetings as far as when those dates would fall.
I'm sorry, what topic are you talking about?
The Herring Township extension offer that we are mulling around, which would give them an extra year. They've not responded at all.
And just as a brief recap, as you know, the City Council was debating a variety of issues regarding offering the extension, and then you kind of said, let's put that on hold and first find out if they're even interested in it.
Okay.
And we revisit it once we knew that they, in fact, really wanted us to push it forward. So that's what we're waiting for.
And that was their main concern from our meeting that we had face-to-face, was that time was of the essence, and we tried to give them time. All right, I'd like to thank Joy Vandree, the Back to the Bricks folks that put this together, the folks from Flint who came up here to promote Flint, and also Northern Michigan, and the hot rods, the old cars that will bring back a lot of memories for anyone who as my age, for example, I'm only in my early 50s somewhat here, and I remember a lot of those cars, and my father had a convertible that was there, so it just brought back a lot of memories.
I thought about him when I saw those.
Yes. So, great crowd, amazing crowd, a lot of positive. The comments we're receiving is this is a town that embraced this activity. They want to come back. So this couldn't have gone better. I was speaking to ABC 12, which is a Flint station, about Cadillac. We got to promote our city throughout Michigan, and they were inviting us down to Flint. So that might be fun to go down and see the actual event. But this was kind of a roadshow of the event, and the General Lee was there. An Indy-type car, over $200,000, was there. It was just really a nice group of cars that would bring tears to your eyes in some cases, just from the history. That an amazing crowd for a Monday. People I haven't seen since high school were there. They're car buffs, and that's why they came out. But it drew people like no tomorrow. And so just very proud to be from Cadillac to have an event occur here and have it go so well. Councilmember Shippers.
Yeah, Cadillac is cruising. A lot of I've gotten comments from folks from near and far that have been reading about the sculpture project, this connection with Flint. I think that Joy's doing a great job, and our city is doing a great job. I'd also like to reiterate what Councilmember Stevens said about our meeting. It's nice to sit at a table with people and look at what each of the townships needs and listen and figure that, you know, we can meet each other's needs. We can do something that is a win-win for everybody. And I think this is something that I hope continues, and with many other things. I would also like to, it has nothing to do with here so much, but support the women that are on the Capitol steps tonight and for V-Day. And be thankful that we are not silenced here based on our politics or our gender.
Okay. Councilmember Spolman.
Spolman.
I'm sorry. Got the two gals mixed up.
I'd like to take us back a moment to the beginning of the meeting during public comment. I thought that was great that Mr. Bedovinic, is that how you say his name, introduced himself because he's running for prosecutor. But I would encourage the mayor and the rest of the council to support a 3-minute limit for public comment at the beginning of the meetings, just because we do have an extremely loaded agenda usually. And I think in the fairness to all that, I certainly would appreciate that. I'm also really pleased that we were able to work through the farm market sign issue. I know that we had some a bit of a situation with that last week, and originally we had granted the farm market permission to put their signs out on Mitchell Street, and I'm glad that we didn't have to renege on that. It just makes sense that we do that. We need to work with the farm market to be able to do it. It's a huge draw in this community. It really helps connect people with the food that they eat and with local farmers. There's a lot of good economic reasons to do it. There's a sense of community there. It's a health issue. It just makes sense that we support this. If we're so lucky to have a farm market in this community, and I have all the faith in the world that the Planning Commission is going to figure out a way to make everybody happy with this sign issue. It is nice to see that there is a new business coming to town, a distillery. It's kind of creative and very entrepreneurial. I'm glad that we're supporting it. I'm looking forward to visiting there someday. I'm on the Lake Mitchell Improvement Board. We had a meeting a couple of Saturdays ago, and we also treated the lake last week. We had to get off the lake on one day because of all of the wind. But the reports are that because we had, not just we, Lake Mitchell, but many lakes in the state of Michigan and elsewhere, because we had that early spring where we had about 8 days of 80-degree weather and early ice off, late ice on, that we really are struggling with how to treat or manage Eurasian water milfoil and other plants. So it looks like this is probably one of the worst years that we're going to have, and we're treating it very aggressively. But we've already had people on Lake Mitchell who are boaters, residents there, really complaining about the weeds that are already present, and it's very unusual to have that many present this time of year.
Okay. Thank you, Councilmember Spolman. Marcus, if you get a chance, I'd appreciate if you could have Mr. Homier look at the paperwork that was presented to see if we could implement a citywide ban as proposed. With that, looks like we have a closed session to...
You're talking about a citywide ban on the synthetic?
Yes.
The...
And milfoil.
The legislature, the governor is signing
happening in the state.
A ban tomorrow.
Oh, good.
So the House passed it last week, and the governor is signing it tomorrow. It will take effect July 1.
Great.
So we don't need a local?
Nope.
Well, he's on the right track then, in terms of...
You're on the right track with our legislative body.
IT right, those two on the right. We have right coming up a lot tonight.
All right. I told you things were going well tonight.
Things are going right.
Now that is government really at work fast.
Yeah,
yes, tonight and tomorrow the governor signs it. So.
We acted quick
on that. So we can say thank you very much.
Right. Do we need a motion at this point to go into closed session to discuss a written legal opinion of the city attorney and pending litigation?
Yes, Mr. Mayor, and as well to invite Jerry Adams, Community Development Director.
Okay. Who would like to make that motion?
I will make that motion, as stated by our illustrious mayor.
And our city manager as well. Thank you. And is there support for that illustrious motion? Okay. There is. Can we please vote?
Councilmember Spolman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Nelima?
Yes.
Clifford?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried. We're off to closed session. We'll be back shortly.
The green light on?
The green light's on, ladies and gentlemen. We are back after our closed session, but before we actually formally come back into session, we're going to need a vote, and before that, a motion and support.
Make a motion to come into open session.
All right.
Support.
Very good. So we have a motion and support to return to open session, and with that, Chris, could we please have a roll call?
Councilmember Stevens?
Yes.
Nelima?
Yes.
Clifford?
Yes.
Spolman?
Yes.
Mayor Barnett?
Yes. Motion carried. We're back in open session. Anything to report, Mr. Petcha?
Not at this time, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council.
All right. Thank you, everybody, for waiting. We are going to adjourn this meeting. Our next meeting is, by the way, July 2nd?
July 2nd.
All right. We'll see you then. Thanks, everyone. Meeting adjourned.